This program is a Warren Stiebel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line is made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Seymour Hersh's book, The Dark Side of Camelot, triggered another round of activist curiosity about the private life of John F. Kennedy. And, of course, the private life of JFK has a public life to it. If the charge is correct that democratic hygiene was sacrificed in order to get him elected, then private lives do have considerable public consequences. Our guests today are two historians who have written very extensively about John Kennedy. Thomas Reeves, a professor at the University of Wisconsin, wrote a bestseller 8 years ago called A Question of Character, A Life of John F. Kennedy. In that book, he reveals his long service as a JFK loyalist, and then progressive disenchantment, as he turned his historical skills to the subject, concluding that Kennedy, quotes, was without any guiding intellectual, philosophical, or moral vision in pursuit of his office. Professor Reeves is author of many other books, most recently Empty Church, The Suicide of Liberal Christianity. Author Schlesinger is, by common acknowledgement, the most prominent historian in America. He too is the author of many books, especially relevant here his book 1,000 Days on the 1,000 Days of Camelot and Robert Kennedy and His Times. Professor Schlesinger is a proud Kennedy loyalist who insists on the irrelevance of stories about Kennedy and sex and about the prominence of Joe Kennedy in the White House story. Well, let's begin by asking Mr. Reeves this. On the matter of an ungoverned, perhaps ungovernable libido, there is pretty settled historical opinion that Kennedy had this problem, but are we talking about a weakness of character that affected Kennedy's competence or judgment as President of the United States?
Well, we are, and I wrote a book about that, A Question of Character. Character is not everything for a chief executive. I called it in the chapter The Vital Framework. We know what character is. It's been talking about for a couple thousand years. We're talking about integrity and responsibility and prudence and temperance. And the way that Joe Kennedy raised his children, the moral consequences of what they did were irrelevant, or at least secondary. And the Kennedys were raised to win, and they were raised to win at any cost. And Jack Kennedy, of whom there is a great deal of misunderstanding, when he found himself in the White House, simply was unable, at least early in the administration, I'm sad to report, to create within himself, to move beyond the way he had been trained and the way he had lived all those decades. And the result of this is a very sad story indeed. Seymour Hersh wrote a bad book. It's bad in a number of ways. And yet it has, through a series of interviews, expanded our knowledge of Kennedy in a way that neither Mr. Schlesinger and I would have wanted.
Maybe we better give Mr. Schlesinger a chance to comment on on the first act.
I don't know, Tom, whether you ever knew Kennedy. He was a friend of mine. I worked for him for 3 years for the 1,000 Days in the White House. He was a man of considerable moral and social vision. The difference between his public and private personality there was no difference really between them. I do not believe that the Seymour Hersh book is a really ridiculous book. He's the most gullible investigative reporter perhaps in American history. He will believe anything so long as it discredits John Kennedy. The if he were a competent investigative reporter, when presented with the Marilyn Monroe forgeries, he would have reflected that the last person Joe Kennedy would have chosen for a delicate mission of bribing Marilyn Monroe would be the personal lawyer of Cardinal Spellman, because Cardinal Spellman and the Kennedys detested each other. But not being a responsible or competent investigative reporter.
How did he get so far, by the way, if you're so incompetent?
He did one great thing, which was the Mili massacre. After
how
that,
you know
nothing.
How did that was great?
The what?
How do you know? How can you trust him on that?
Because his subsequent books, like the one he wrote about your friend Henry and mine, Henry Kissinger, the book he wrote about the Korean airline, which has a conspiracy theory no one takes seriously. People peak too soon.
How do you handle somebody like Thomas Powers, who's a very creditable guy, and very measured in his inflections? He wrote in the New York Times, Hearst has tied a great many separate strands together here to create a new convincing and troubling tale of a man who has lost control of his appetites and is beginning to realize he is knee-deep in the tar baby. Now, was he simply gulled?
Yes, I think he was gulled. The theme of, one theme of the book is that the recklessness in private life led to recklessness in public policy. For example, the great deal is made by both Powers and by Hirsch of the Bay of Pigs operation and the assassination projects against Castro. Well, those were initiatives of the Eisenhower administration. Sam Giancana was installed by the Eisenhower administration in hired by the CIA to attempt to kill Castro months before Kennedy became president. The whole Bay of Pigs operation was hatched in the Eisenhower administration. If recklessness were the presidential recklessness were the cause of these things, the reckless president was obviously Eisenhower, not Kennedy.
Well, I disagree entirely. Mr. Schlesinger has been saying this, with all due respect, has been saying this since 1965. And for a long time, I hoped that it was true, but it isn't.
What do you mean?
The evidence, well.
The Church Committee established that Giancana and Rosselli were installed in September 1960, months before.
I know that.
Well, then how can you say that I'm wrong when
I say
this was an initiative of the Eisenhower
administration? It is, of course, an initiative, but this assumes...
Well, then where am I wrong?
You're wrong in assuming that Kennedy didn't play a major role in the Bay of Pigs, or that he didn't know Sam Giancana, or that he didn't know Marilyn Monroe, and that the interviews that Seymour Hirsch devised are false. They aren't.
I didn't say that.
The interviews that Seymour Hirsch gave us, in many ways, are very important. I don't want to defend a bad book at great length, but... He said he interviewed more than 1,000 people. I counted at least 25 of those interviews that are terrific. See, what the audience has to understand is that there's been a concerted effort by the Kennedy family, with the assistance of a number of at least two prominent members of the former administration, to keep historians from finding out who the Kennedys really were.
How do they exercise those pressures?
Well, they have done it in a number of ways. Used their authority at the Kennedy Library, for example, to keep things silent and keep things as quiet as they can. Here's another example.
What could you not find in the Kennedy Library?
Well, there are millions of pages that are kept from us. Here's an example. Seymour Hirsch interviewed Governor Patterson of Alabama. He was privy to what was going on before the Bay of Pigs invasion. He went to see John F. Kennedy while he was a candidate. And he told him what was going on, that there's going to be an invasion. Mr. Schlesinger says that he didn't know about that. He said, it's going to happen. We know about it, and we're contributing to it in Alabama. We're helping them with National Guardsmen. So Kennedy made no response, Patterson says. He seemed to know all about it anyway. Of course, he did. But then, when we get the interview from the Kennedy Library, all of that's left out. And Mr. Patterson says, they left it out for so-called security reasons. So Seymour Hirsch and his squad of researchers pouring throughout the country and finding people that many historians could never have found, given his time and his money and his resources, found Patterson and asked him what happened, and he told it to us. That's a kind of suppression of evidence.
How do you account for that, Professor Schlesinger?
First place on the question of Kennedy's knowledge, the CIA published a book on the briefings of presidential candidates, in which they say explicitly that Kennedy was never briefed on the Bay of Pigs before the election. The Hirsch went around the country interviewing all sorts of people and wanted to inflate their own importance in history, and he believed every word they said. That doesn't necessarily prove that the
For the benefit of us amateurs, how do you launch an invasion of Cuba when you're president of the United States and without knowing about it?
Kennedy was trapped.
Why didn't he call it off?
He could not. Look, if he'd called it off, Bill, the attack on him would have been led by you. The fact is that he was trapped. Eisenhower had said to him the day before the inauguration that you must go forward on this. If a Lieutenant J.G. in the Navy had called off an expedition which was sponsored and approved by the general command of the largest amphibious invasion in history, he would have had certain bad political problems to deal with.
You got a little internal problem there. In the first place, he wasn't Lieutenant J.G. He was President of the United States. He was Commander-in-Chief. In the second place, so far as I know, there is no exact historical correspondence between the success of a military operation and the rank of the person who initiated it.
But still, the General Eisenhower commanded a certain amount of respect among the American people as a military authority.
Well, if General Eisenhower had been President Eisenhower, might he have concluded that operation successfully?
He recommended that Kennedy go ahead. The Joint Chiefs of Staff were for it, and so on. It was not easy to call it off.
May I give you another example of what the Kennedy family and its supporters have done?
You may do whatever you like.
The Secret Service people. I called up the Kennedy Library and I was writing my book, and I said, let's put an end to all of these stories by finding out what really went on. Let me see the Secret Service files. And he said, they're closed. The family owns them and they won't let anybody see them. Well, so Seymour Hersh somehow found four of the Secret Service agents, and the picture that they portray of John F. Kennedy is by no means the picture one finds in books by Schlesinger and Sorensen. It's devastating. And these are the people who were with him every day, and you could say, well, Seymour Hersh didn't have to believe them, but there are four of them. And there was one before who talked in another book. So we have five of them.
Mr. Reeves, let's focus on this, because I'm prepared, as I said in my introduction, to concede that there was a priapic problem there. But do we conclude from that his judgment was affected in general matters? Now, for instance, if somebody's a terrific alcoholic,
I know.
You're entitled to deduce that he might just not be all that reliable in critical moments, as was said about Yeltsin on several occasions. But if you have that particular problem, Saudi rises, does that breed a particular problem that is relevant to the Kennedy story?
See, there are two issues here. One of them is, were the character flaws real? Mr. Schlesinger takes the position that they weren't. Mr. Sorensen calls it all fantasy. You've at least given acquiescence to at least some of it. Seymour Hersh has extended this way beyond what my book did, because he found more people than I did who would talk. That's one issue. Is it true? It is. The second issue is, does it matter?
Mm-hmm, right.
And that's the issue that I think is the more interesting of the articles.
Did it matter with Harding?
Well, yes. Did it matter with Harding? Did it matter with Nixon? Did it matter with LBJ?
But Nixon didn't have that problem, as far as we know.
Not that problem, no. But I think that Kennedy and Nixon are the two most immoral men who ever sat in the White House. It's a toss-up. You could argue, you could have a program about which of them was the worst. But does character matter, especially when you're president of the United States? No one talked more about moral leadership and character than John F. Kennedy himself. And he was leading a double life, which in retrospect, you can you not only find shameful, but you can find traces of it in his decisions. He was not the awful human being that Seymour Hersh makes him out to be. He was not a monster. He had some very good character traits. He gets high points for courage. For courage and glamour, he was smart, not brilliant, as Mr. Schlesinger argues, but he was smart. His IQ, by the way, was 2 points higher than Lee Harvey Oswald, the best we know.
Now that's kind of hit and run.
There are good things.
We don't know anything about Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yes, we do.
We have no idea. Was he brilliant?
No, but Oswald? His IQ was reportedly from 117 to 118. Kennedy
could he
had
have gotten
190.
Into Harvard?
Well, I don't know. Perhaps he hadn't gone to Chota, the Boston Latin School, but in terms of sheer IQ...
We're losing a bit, but let me ask Professor Sessler this. Is it a part of the pro-Kennedy commitment to simply deny the whole sexual business or simply to say, we don't deny, but it's irrelevant?
Everyone's sex life is a mystery. I don't know.
That's pretty invasive. Come on, because it's...
But I would say if half the things alleged by Seymour Hersh or Trulli would never have had time to do anything else, the notion that there was a parade of bimbos going through the White House is just ridiculous for those who worked in the White House. If there were so many of these women, why did not one of them sell their reminiscences to National Enquirer for millions of dollars?
It makes that inherently implausible, doesn't it?
Yeah. But I would say that the preopic side, there was no more preopic British prime minister than Lloyd George. Yeah. Lloyd George was an immensely successful, both as a social reformer and as a prime minister during the First World War. I once heard a discussion comparing Martin Luther King and Pol Pot. Now, Martin Luther King was a man who did great things for this country. He was a moral leader, but he had a very wayward private life. Pol Pot was an admirable family man, but all he did was murder a million of his countrymen. Seems to me that the relation...
Well, nobody.
I think we are a very hypocritical nation, that any man who could command...
Therefore, we need immoral leaders.
Any man who could command the adultery vote in this country would win in a landslide.
I don't think anybody's trying to set up a correlation here. No. One, as I understand it, is asking the question in two parts. Number one, would you guys please go to sleep on the matter of this being a Kennedy problem, measured in conventional terms? And having gone to sleep on that problem, would you insist that it is absolutely irrelevant?
I think there's no connection between private recklessness and public recklessness.
No, but the thing
I think if you read the Kennedy tapes, the account of the missile crisis, you'll see a man who is cool, controlled, purposeful, listens carefully, speaks carefully, and came to the right decision.
Now, there's another case in point, the Kennedy tapes. When they were announced, Mr. Schlesinger said publicly they couldn't possibly existed. He never would have done something like that.
I was wrong.
He was wrong. So then they appeared, and 95% of them are kept from us. Now, if the Kennedy family
95%?
Really wants...
95%?
Oh, at least
Is that your figure or Hersh's figure?
It's my figure. It might also be Hersh's figure, come to think of it. So what they do is they release one small excerpt of the tapes, which has to do where Jack was holding the button and talking into the microphone. Only he and Bobby knew that those were there. And what we would like, the Kennedy family and the Kennedy Library and the people who are from what I call the Camelot School, what we would like them to do, if they really want to clear up the story, is to let us have all the tapes. There are hundreds.
You got a problem with that?
I'm all in favor of that. I would point out that these tapes deal with the most dangerous moment in the Cold War, the one time that nuclear war was a real possibility.
You might offend Brezhnev.
And I think that they show Kennedy's extraordinary personal quality.
Except that the real bargaining was going on behind the scenes, and XCOM didn't, the committee he was talking to, didn't really know about it. And that is a contribution of the new book by Seymour.
On the contrary, I wrote about that in my book in 1978 called Robert Kennedy and His Times. I was the first to disclose what had happened. It's not a contribution of Seymour Hersh, for God's sake.
Well, it's a question of the expansion of what you wrote.
He found
FBI men, he found CIA men. Our knowledge of this now is much greater than it has been before Seymour Hersh.
The thrust of these discoveries was what?
Well, it depends on what issue you're talking about, but he found at least a dozen such people who broadened our knowledge of Sam G. and Khanna and of Judith Campbell Exner and of the Cuban Missile Crisis and Bobby Kennedy. He did so largely through his uncanny ability to find people who were there. I mean, you can't say that anybody who was in the White House wouldn't have known about this. The point is that there were people who saw it. They were Secret Service people. They were ex-FBI people. They were CIA people.
And let's consider some of these great revelations. He says LBJ blackmailed.
Well, that's a bad chapter.
Kennedy. And
that's a bad chapter.
And then in the same book, he says that Kennedy was preparing to drop Johnson from the ticket. Apparently, the blackmail power had expired. And said that replace him by Robert Kennedy, which would have been unconstitutional. You can't have two candidates from the same state.
He doesn't understand that.
It wouldn't have been unconstitutional if he had moved to a different state.
No, but
in fact, Bobby.
But any case, the whole thing is ridiculous.
Let me ask this: what is the responsibility
on this
of
John Khanna thing? If John Khanna had all this stuff on the Kennedys, why did he never use it to protect himself? He was sent to prison for a year. If John Khanna were
well, our knowledge
he had no blackmail.
Maybe it was 1 year or 10 years.
No. Our knowledge now of Kennedy and Giancana is extremely impressive. There's no question about this.
Well, let's take the Chicago thing. See, yeah. Hirsch has the chapter, yeah, saying that Joe Kennedy, in the winter of 59-60, months before his son was nominated for president, had made a deal with Giancana to carry Chicago. He didn't even know his son was going to win the nomination. Of course, the chapter is an insult to the memory of Dick Daley, yeah, the mayor of Chicago.
How can you?
It was Daley, who, Daley who controlled Chicago, not Giancana. The notion that the mob was had the capacity to deliver voters to the polls, again, is ridiculous. The one big union, which was infiltrated by the mob and controlled by the mob, was the Teamsters, and they were for Nixon in that election. Well, this whole notion of what does he call the chapter? The stolen election, and he puts it all on Giancana, and all in this fictitious meeting.
Again, you're arguing inherent impossibility, which appeals to me. But let me ask you: you're both professional historians. What is the obligation, given the present situation, to affect what they nowadays call closure? Here are four live Secret Service people who say to Hirsch, ABC. Professor Schlesinger says that's simply inconceivable. ABC could not have happened. I, as a layman, as a reader, want to know who's correct. So where does history take us from there?
Well, look on the Secret Service. Joe Pilella was one of the people. Has said that he was misquoted. When the book was sent to me, I almost fainted. I was so embarrassed. He wrote a letter to a friend in the Secret Service saying, I did not say I enjoyed being near the president, as quoted by Hirsch, I enjoyed being near the president who attracted women at every stop. Furthermore, I never told Hirsch that, quote, drinking and partying became a constant feature of presidential travel, and so on.
So how do we handle that, Mr. Reeves?
You take the overall view. You take as many pieces of the puzzle as you possibly can and try and make a picture out of them. And the pieces of the puzzle, since A Thousand Days appeared in 1965 by Mr. Schlesinger, points in one direction overwhelmingly. I think only two people of the hundreds, he said over 1,000 interviews that were done in this new book, only two people have complained that they were misquoted. The key people throughout the book, the FBI people, the CIA people, the people who saw the transcripts of tapes that they won't give us, have said that what they were quoted as saying is true.
Well, let me ask you, Mr. Schlesinger, in your capacity as an eminent historian with a lot of drag, what kind of pressure have you put on the Kennedy people to publicize these, give people access to these tapes?
Well, I'm all in favor of it. I have no great authority.
I
tell you, a lot of the stuff is closed for security reasons, and historians in general have been pressing for the, I mean, the whole notion of keeping anything that happened 20 years ago. In fact, most of the stuff that happened during the Cold War ought to be released. As you know, I was one of the great advocates of the release of the Venona documents.
Well,
and
I believe
that everything should be disclosed.
As Seymour, you know, in England, there's a statute of limitations. After 30 years, you can have anything.
Well, more
it's,
or
it's
less.
But it's been more than 30 years since the kind of stuff we're talking about.
Well, Seymour Hersh,
I think they should all be released.
I do, too. And Seymour Hersh, in his last pages, tells us better than I did about what the Kennedy family has done with the documents. I mean, it's a deliberate attempt to keep historians from them. For one thing, they had them for almost 13 years before they turned them over to archivists. And when the archivists finally got to them, they found boxes, tape boxes empty. They found there was a man who was hired to deliberately go through these papers and cull things that were embarrassing. When you go to the Kennedy Library, you won't even find a picture, a photograph of Kennedy frowning. I mean, it is all pure Camelot.
See, that's pretty fastidious stuff.
And historians simply shouldn't anymore tolerate it.
Is there a picture of you frowning, Arthur? Thank you very much, Professor Reeves, Professor Schlesinger. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
This program was a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, and the Friends of Firing Line. For information about a video cassette of this program, write to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. Or call 803-799-3449. That's Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. Or call 803-799-3449.